Okay, then, okay, I suggest we now start with the lecture, because all the stories are not relevant to the lecture. Sampling conversation. I do three parts. I think I skipped the appendices. I will look what is that. I split up in sampling, quantization. Quantization goes somewhat quicker. And sampling, you will see many things that we have already seen yesterday. They are now very simple. First, okay, this box schematic again, this generic box schematic. This is, in fact, this is an architecture. Because these blocks, yeah, they are mystic blocks. You only say what they are doing, not how it is done. And what we are focusing now is the A to D converters and also the D to A converters. This is a remark that already made. If you sample an analog signal and you do this in a proper way, if you choose your sampling interval small enough, sufficiently small, then you can perfectly reconstruct your analog signal. This is the most important part of this set of slides and the theorem about it. It's a very simple theorem, but it was officially set up by Claude Shannon from Bell Labs, of course, in 1948. And I think it was 10 years before, or at least 10 years before, by Kotelnikov in Russia, but they didn't know, because there was no information exchange during Stalin's time. Now, the other, if you quantize a signal, you lose information. You really lose information, you're never able to reconstruct your analog signal again. 100%. You'll see how this works. Here's the CD again, just to give you an example of of the specifications, what happens. So your CD is a whole selection on a disk with small points to be written by a laser pin diode and from a laser. And you have the sampling and you have the quantization. And if you combine them together, look at the units. This is 1,000 samples per second. So kilohertz samples per second is more correct. And you have the quantization in bits per sample. If you multiply them, then the unit you get is bits per second. And you really have the a unit that is used for transmission on long lines. And also in storage, because then you're using, then you use bytes, it is 8 bits. Storage capacity, bits per second. This is just some introduction, but I think it helps you to be aware what we have, what the impact can be if you have sampled signal. This is about D to A conversion. In fact, here I've is it 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 7 samples. Now, if this is my information before A to D conversion, my question is, what would be the reconstruction of my analog signal? Well, most people say this. This is correct, but is that the only one? What do you think? Should it be the only possible reconstruction?
No, you're wrong with the answer.
That is not a good question. This is not the only one. There's another reconstruction. You can also do this. This is less obvious, but you can also do this. Yeah. And it should be the only two of it. No. It's clear that there is an infinite number, it's a mess, infinity a large number of possible waves to reconstruct. Without looking at the numerics here, you see that from these points, you can have the one that is the lowest frequency, which is the most obvious. The others are, in fact, are aliased. I get the term again from, and then I use Peter's term again, from the higher Nyquist zones. We'll come to that here during this. They originate because you did not use a proper filter before your A to D conversion. If you just do A to D conversions without low pass filter, you get all the rubbish you can get. But if you do a low pass filter before your A to D converter, you get only the first one, because that's the only one that is passed and the rest is rejected. So, okay, skip the. This is just an introduction to give you an awareness of what you're doing with A to D conversion and D to A conversion. First, we focus on the A to D conversion, and okay, we are quickly going to Shannon's sampling theorem, Copernican sampling theorem, and after the story of yesterday, it's very simple. Then to the D to A converter, the reconstruction, and okay, we are back with. Nyquist pulse criterion, how to do a perfect signal reconstruction, which of course is impossible, but you have to define what should be available. At the input, you don't have a box for many, but before you do sampling, ideal sampling, with this infinitely long sequence of Dirac pulses, you have a low pass filter, and I call this an anti-aliasing filter. It's just to prevent all this other rubbish that you saw to pass through. The anti-aliasing filter rejects all these higher frequencies. So one of the things is you put a band limit on your analog signal. And if you have a large analog signal, you might lose information. If you want all the information in an analog signal, you put a low-pass filter where all your analog information is, and this determines your the rate at which you are going to sample. Let's sit here. The Shannon. Tells you something about the sampling rate that is minimally required to make a reconstruction of your analog signal possible. And now there's a formula, skip this, I go to the picture. Is it readable? I think so. I take a harmonic signal again, and this is the spectrum of my harmonic signal cosine. We saw yesterday, and now we're going to sample, and we multiply this cosine with this Dirac pulse, this Dirac pulse train, and it means you convolve this with this infinite length of spectral spikes. Now, if you do this, you replicate this here, replicate it here. So you get here a spectrum, here you get a copy of the 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 spectrum. Now, this is the effect of sampling, and now you also already can. if you are aware, you can already see where you will get problems. Your sampling frequency, that is the, this is FS by the way, FS, and this F0 is the frequency of the cosine. And you get problems, because this is your original spectrum, and the others are just replicas. They are not the real signals, but you get them as a present, an unwanted present, because you have sampled. If your frequency increases, then these, the distance between these become wider, but also these become wider. And when do they start to overlap? When they are at the point at half FS. Here's where when F0 starts to become equal at half the sampling frequency, then you will get a problem. And this is exactly what Shannon's theorem tells you. You should always take care that your signal frequency, your maximum signal frequency, and I took a harmonic, so this is the only signal frequency, is not beyond, not larger than half the sampling frequency. This also, I also give an example. Okay, this is one of the slides that is very important. Here it is, and okay, this is also for noise-free signal, by the way. And okay, this is more generic. If the double-sided bandwidth 2B, I replaced the F0 by B. 2B, then the minimum required sampling rate, is 2B. here you get it in the the formulation again that I told you, you have to choose your sampling rate, your sampling frequency, larger than 2 times the maximum frequency, 2 times F0. And the point where when the F0 is exactly half FS is called the Nyquist rate. That is the.
Can I have a question? What does double sided mean?
I do work with double sided frequency spectrum.
So plus and minus?
Plus and minus frequency, yeah. Minus frequency, minus 50 hertz, only means I rotate my phase or polarize.
So this is just for mathematical completeness, right?
Going to complex harmonics, so e to the power of g, and this needs represented by single phase or single spectrum. To create a real signal, I need two phases, one rotating in this direction, and the other direction. And if you sum them up, and you're always in the lead axis, you have your cosine bandwidth. So I always use two-sided bandwidths, and of course your oscilloscope can go from 0 to some. But you, because you work with real signals in the world, you implicitly know what for frequency spectrum for the negative frequency will be. Because your amplitude is even and your phase is odd. But it falls directly from the property of the symmetry property of your Fourier transform. So you will be aware of this, but you have enough from 0 to something hertz, and you can deconstruct from 0 to minus something hertz. But the information you have is already there. But you have two-sided bandwidth. And okay, here's some example from speech and from music. The telephone is 300 to 3.4 kilohertz. And so this is below the large, the maximum frequency here is 3.4 kilohertz. Now, smaller than and 8 kilohertz is larger than 2 times 3.4, 6.8, and normally your telephone channels also in PCM, also in FDM. You have a low pass, this is low pass, you have a low pass filter at 4 kilohertz, and this is for anti-aliasing before you sample. If you have a low pass filter of 4 kilohertz, then you're sure that there are no frequencies higher than 4 kilohertz, and you can sample at 8 kilohertz, just to prevent the aliasing. This is for music, and you can. For any shit.
Practical question. Sometimes when you speak to another person, there is an echo phenomenon. Ah. Like you can hear your voice again.
Yeah.
How is that possible? Why is that happening?
It has nothing to do with this. No.
Nothing to do with this.
This is transmission line phenomenon. And I'm not going to have a lecture. There is a, if you have a transmission line for telephones, especially analog telephone lines, you go from a two-wire, at the transmitter, you go from a two-wire connection to a four-wire connection, and the component who does that is called a hybrid. So you have, and a hybrid balances between of this four wire, two wires going forth to your receiver, and the other two wires are from your receiver for backwards talking. And in the hybrid, there should be a balance. No, the echo is because in the hybrid there's an imbalance. Yeah. The hybrid is a network with four gates.
Yeah.
The input is with two lines.
Yeah.
This is port one. The other port two and port three are the lines going to the receiver and from the receiver backwards. And there is a fourth port, which should be zero output. And
but sometimes it
happens, did not. Yeah. And if you do it, then you get echoes.
Yes.
The echo line is that you have some feedback in your line.
Yes.
Over this.
Which
port
is
three.
Normally not the case, but sometimes.
Yeah. If it's not well balanced.
Yeah.
Which is not this phenomenon. Not.
Last
question. No, aliasing, if you have aliasing, you perceive it in another way. You do not, you get your original sound back, but you get all kinds of
noise.
Yeah, you get it's noisy. It's not crosstalk, because that's also different, because then you speak in your telephone and you hear someone else talking in your phone from nearby wire. So, that is the method of the KGB to listen to me. You have a coil around all the lines, but that's not possible anymore because all telephones are digital. And even the criminals, well, now they work with encrypted data, so that's another topic. Now, okay, well, I will not do this, but because lack of time. I can give you the model and you can play it. This is what Peter asked me yesterday. You saw all these intervals where these replicas, these false replicas of the spectra. There's one that is true, which is around 0 hertz, and the other ones are false replicas. Now, the first one, we call the first Nyquist song, So this, yeah, this signal that you want, no aliasing. The other ones, you just get, but you have to take care that they do not have overlap, and they call them the second, third, and the fourth Nyquist zone. That is a name, just a name, how they are called. And Nyquist, of course, is because it is maximum rate that you that you are assigned with. And okay, that is what we're going to do now. What happens if we sum if the maximum frequency in my signal, and I for the example I will take a harmonic again. What happens if the frequency of my harmonic is exactly half the sampling frequency? You get some interesting phenomenon. And you do this, and now you become more clear what happens. We have your harmonic, and what I do is I sample, this is the way I sample. This is the period T0 of my harmonic, and this is the sampling interval in time. And what you see, in fact, you sample twice per period. Eh? That is Shannon's theorem in time domain. And now you are just at the edge. Now, I put it in such a way that if you are unlucky, you just sample here at the zeros. And what you see is nothing. You get zero faults out. That is the... But if you now shift this grid a bit, then suddenly, hey, there is a signal. But this is not the maximum. And if you shift this, at this point, yeah, then you have the signal again. So sampling at exactly the Nyquist frequency and where half the sampling rate is equal to the max to this frequency gives a very strange phenomenon. So it should always be smaller than half FS, not equal, always smaller. Equal gives you, if it is equal, gives you this strange phenomenon. Yes, another demonstration, a few demonstrations. If you can play around with it. First, you have a constant sampling rate in your A to D converter, and you see, and you observe what harmonics, how the harmonics will pass. If we do a low frequency, it's easy, you get all these points. Now, it's easy to reconstruct them. If I increase the frequency with my oscilloscope and I sample, then it becomes somewhat more difficult to reconstruct. And here, if I have the sampling frequency, your harmonic frequency too high, far above half FS, then you get this phenomenon. And yeah, you get this stroboscopic effect. And I chose it almost one, so it's far beyond the Nyquist rate. And so then there is no difference if you receive this type, this sampling, this cluster of samples. You do not know how to reconstruct. You reconstruct this one. You reconstruct the false one. And this is called the aliased version of this one. You falsely reconstruct a component which is in the first Nyquist zone. It should not be aliased in the zero hertz.
Something to do with the effect when we point out the camera toward the wheel of a car.
That is exactly, that is a very good example. Yep.
Backward motion.
Yeah, that is exactly the same phenomenon. This is not only electronically developed, optically, in a stroboscope. If you, I do not like discotheques, but you know, discotheques have all these flashing lights and you see people moving very slowly.
Yes.
They're not moving very slowly, but this is because of the sampling. And the stroboscopic lights sample too low, and then that's what. But this is a good example of the wheel of your car or motorcycle moving backwards. Yes.
Because we observe discrete movements, otherwise forward motion.
Yeah. And in this case, it is your eyes that sample. Because
Or
televisions are designed for human eyes. And human eyes, I think it has been tested in during the beginning of the 20th century, the refreshment of your television screen, of the analog television screen, is 25 hertz. And this is just the frequency that your eyes are able to sample. And if you have a dog or a cat watching your TV, there's far better eyes, doesn't see anything, he sees still images changing every time. And if you, that's also a good example. If you have a 50 hertz glowing bulb and you have a chicken farm and full of glowing bulbs, all the chickens go crazy. Because what they see all this completely crazy. They have far better eyes than, birds have far better eyes than, they're completely crazy because it is 50 hertz flashing. We don't know 50 hertz, we don't, because our eyes are too slow to sample. Yeah, it's a good example. Yeah,
the turning wheel.
Yeah. Okay, I can reverse the problem. I can have a fixed harmonic wave. Yes, this is the spectrum. And I put this because this is then it is related to 0 hertz, not 0 hertz. And I keep the and this frequency fixed, and now I start to manipulate the sampling rate. First, I have a very high sampling rate. Now, then I end up with this spectrum. And it's, from time domain, it's easy to see, okay, this will be the reconstruction, and there is here no overlap. Now I decrease the sampling rate, and now it becomes more difficult. I only get fewer samples per period. And you also already see, because here the sampling rate is increasing, then here the distance between the Nyquist songs decrease. All these figures, they are approaching one another. And dus nou de sampling rate is too low, then all these pictures start to overlap, but then you have aliasing. So this is okay, all a pictorial example what okay the consequences if you sample with too low frequency or at a given sampling frequency sent too high frequency to your A to D converter. There is a question, I will skip this. You can do, you can try it out for yourself. And the answer is, given 3 kilohertz signals, you have this, 5 kilohertz signals, and you sample with 8 kilohertz. Now, this one obviously produces this. This is without aliasing, and 5 kilohertz. You replicate this here, and you get an overlap, but now you see in your observation. What you observe, you observe from minus fs, half fs, plus half fs, you perceive minus 3 plus 3. These are not, and these are the aligned versions from your first Nyquist song. This is not the signal itself, no. It is a false signal. Because your frequency is too high with respect to your sampling rate. Okay, then, what time shall we have a break? Let's continue. It's not a large piece, fortunately, so we can get back on track. So, sometime. The D2A side. Okay, once you have a sampled signal, how to reconstruct it? What problems do you encounter there? If you reconstruct, you have your ideal sampling rate, and this is a model, this is not, but if you sample, if you reconstruct, all the Dirac pulses, they are not Dirac pulses, they are rectangular pulses or something else, they result from sample and hold, and you reconstruct by low-pass filtering this sequence of physical pulses. And the Nyquist theorem is closely related to Shannon's Kotelnikov's theorem, but it only appeals to the D2A converter side. Once you have a whole sequence of pulses, you can try to experiment what is the maximum pulse rate when you have this low pass filter. I'm now aware that the slides are a bit light. I use a pencil and not a real black. What you have here, okay, this is already something of systems. Here you have a model of your sampler. What you have here is your ideal sequence of Dirac pulses, and what you get here out is, because this is a band limited low pass filter, low pass filtering, and it has, and then what is then the response? Now, this is an impulse, so you get the impulse response, and impulse response, as we know now, is the Fourier transform of this rectangular ideal low pass filter, which is this sync function. Now, this is one, but if I immediately after it, I get a second pulse, new pulse, then at what position, what is the minimum time that is allowed to put this sample here? Okay, here it is, if I put it here, it's okay, but if I have a high sampling rate, then this goes more to this. And what happens here now? I get this sync pulse, and the other is here is creeping down, approaching this one, and the minimum distance of the next following sync pulse, you place it the maximum of the next pulse on the zero of the present pulse. This is the maximum, the minimum, sampling interval that you can achieve with this ideal filter. low-pass filter. And I have to read myself what is it. I just already, okay, what I already said in word, what I already said is here in words. If this interval is large enough, then, okay, these two pulses, you can separate from one another. Yeah? And if they are too close together, then that you can't separate them anymore. If this is going down and it has not been zero yet, and you already see another maximum, you cannot separate them anymore. This has already been zero, and then the other still has to reach its maximum, then you are able to separate. This is called inter-symbol interference, and this is the counterpart of aliasing in the frequency domain. Inter-symbol interference, aliasing.
Arranging criteria for optics for the overlapping ways up to light sources. Yes, right?
I want to get you get out of the course. You're perfectly honest. You are you're far ahead because that is also what you will get in the spatial agents form.
Okay.
Yeah? But it's good to think of this, but this is 100% correct.
Okay.
Yes. Yes.
Recognize
yeah, this is okay. Yeah, this the picture. Okay, yeah, okay.
It tells it in fact.
Now, what happens if I for a low pass filter is not ideal? Ah, for example, and now okay, I go back to previous day. Instead of a rectangular. Low-pass filter via a raised cosine low-pass filter. What is the impulse response of a raised cosine low-pass filter? Now, you've seen that is the sum, the addition, the linear combination of three successive sync pulses and I add them up. Then I get here, and this is an example of a Nyquist pulse. It is twice the time duration, but these fringes, which causes inter-symbol interference, are only 2% instead of 13% in the sync pulse alone. So the fringes are much, much lower, but at the cost of pulse length. Now, it's not easy to see what can be the minimum distance between these pulses? Now it's not, it's twice as long as the as in the ideal case, and yeah, this is about reconstruction. So these pulses, by adding them up, right, you get a second pulse, and you get this whole pulse train going through your low-pass filter. So ideal rectangular filter, yeah, you can't make. Then this filter, but what is the best? What is the low-pass filter that gives you, or the filter that gives you perfect reconstruction? Yeah, you have a dilemma. That is the when this reconstruction low pass filter is a sync filter, sync characteristic. So you have it, yeah, you have this sync filter, then you have these pulses. And you have this duration, and they have no inter-symbol interference at all. That's here, zero. More or less perfectly reconstructed signal by this. No inter-symbol interference. But of course, this filter you can't make. With a filter with a sink characteristic. So this is really a dilemma, and this was Nyquist's dilemma 90 years ago, when playing around, pushing pulses through transmission lines, yeah. Before A to D converters came into existence. The first digital signal, by the way, this is, I mentioned in the example, is pulse code modulation. Pulse code modulation is speech samples of 8 bit per sample, and at this rate of 8 kilohertz. And the first experiments were done in 1938 in Paris by ITT, by Mr. Reeves, R-E-V-S. So even before digital communication came into existence, there were already experiments from the notorious company in the world, ITT, Roberts. Okay. Okay. So if this is my ideal low-pass filtered signal, then this is the frequency characteristic, and yeah, you have your, of course, you have your periodic spectrum, and you only want to filter this one out, and the rest you want to reject. Now, brick wall filter is the best, but you can't make it. A sink filter, you always get this, and when you do it. When you have this sequence, yeah, you are you always are condemned to have some aliasing power, and do not have numbers how large this is. There is another sampling method, by the way, and this is not sample, this is sampling too. I told you if you use this is impossible. If you are able to use a sync pulse for a reconstruction of your signal, you get this envelope. This looks, this is more natural than this block-like signal. Of course, such a pulse you cannot make. This belongs to the brick wall filter. And but what you do then is, in frequency domain, you put this brick wall filter here, this rectangular low pass filter, and you ideally filter out all the higher Nyquist zones, and then you have your your ideal D2A converter. And of course, this is not possible because you cannot make ideal brick wall filters, so you don't have the ideal reconstruction pulse. And so the challenge is to what do you accept for aliasing? I think this is the conclusion of the A to D converter and the D to A converter part. Maybe you can, okay, now we can have a coffee break and then have a short part on quantization, which is not very big. You see there are not many formulas anymore, because all the formulas you had yesterday, you can only now apply them and see what happens. Quantization will be an exception. Very few textbooks say something about it. I will try to tell something more. I would tell something more, and for the rest of your career you can forget it. Yeah. you keep in your mind, be aware that you always have for small signals, you can have a quantization effect. But normally, most 99% of the textbook in digital signal processing don't take this into account at all. The only book that does it is the Oppenheim and Schaefer book from 1975. And it's successful. I saw this here in the library. You have this book here. So, am I right, Peter? Yes. Yes.
Yes.
Very good.
It was issued here in 1993.
Uh-huh.
And since there is a kind of a Bible for signals of kind,
Mr. Oppenheim is some freak or so. Spent all his life doing signal processing. Von Bellocks. These are good books. They're not easy to read, by the way, but they're good books.
And everybody, I guess, can find it either in the bookstore at the front of the university or in the library here.
That's also not a possibility, but it's downloaded illegally from internet. But, okay, be aware of this.
We also do that, but they cannot send it.
Yeah, your university, they can send lawyers to you.
Cameras everywhere around.
Yeah, I should not tell this because the microphone is.